Baptist Church this morning. Let's all stand together and let's sing. He is risen indeed. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. If you're visiting, welcome to New Hope Baptist Church. If you're not, good job. You'll be where you're supposed to be.
We are walking in marvelous light, for we are.
All right, if the children this morning have already been dismissed to Children's Church, so if you have kids that want to go to Children's Church this morning, the Children's Church is in a little bit different place. So the Children's Church are in the teen loft right now to watch the stick drama. So if you have kids that would like to go to Children's Church, it is through this door and up the stairs. So if I could have an usher kind of go in and make sure you direct the kids upstairs so we don't have anybody crack a cranium going upstairs. So if any of the kids, wow. Sorry to go back there. That's awesome. And love the kiddos. That is awesome. All right. And if any of the parents want to go with them, you can do that. Just wonderful to be together on Easter morning, celebrate the resurrection. Let's pray together. Lord God, we just love you so much. Lord, we thank you for being a God who loves us and cares so much about us that you would send your Son to die and to rise again. Lord, I pray today that you would give us perspective, and Lord, that you would help us to see clearly, Lord, the meaning of this life and Lord, the purpose that you've given us. Lord, we just pray that you would be with the children's church in the back. Lord, you'd help our kids to see the importance of you in our lives. And Lord, that we would be leaders that would lead people to that cross and Lord, to that empty grave. Lord, we just pray that you would have meaning and purpose in our life that could not be denied. We pray all these things in the precious name of your Son who died and rose again and is alive forevermore. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you so much for being here this morning, and we want to welcome each and every one of you to Easter Sunday. And Easter Sunday is of course, every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday for the Christian, but we're delighted that you are here today. And if you are visiting with us for the first time, I want to invite you to fill out this contact card that you will find inside your bulletin. And you can just tear that off along the perforation and drop it in the offering plate at the end of the service, and then we would have a record of your visit. And so that would be helpful to us. But you are a blessing to us just by being here today, and we trust that you will feel right at church. Our team department has prepared something that is new for New Hope. We've never done it at New Hope before. It's not original with us, but we've just never done it before. And so they're going to present this morning a stick drama. And a stick drama is a drama that's performed where the kids will be using dowel rods and interpretive movement to illustrate two songs for us this morning, Still Her Little Child and Arise, My Love. So I present to you the New Hope Team Department.
Gave him treasure. strength and wisdom. He was still her little child. When he spoke, the people listened. He was still her little child. And when he
says, but the angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where he lay.
Yeah. Spirit would do a work in this room this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
let me thank Miss Tia for the flower arrangement. I didn't mean to make those guys seem weak by getting two guys with some flowers. But those flowers are there. I don't know what kind of flowers they are, but they're there. And it is a wonderful day in the house of the Lord. Any day is a wonderful day in God's house, and we are just excited to be celebrating once again this year the resurrection of our Lord, which makes life possible. When he conquered death, it's that day and it's that event which makes it possible for you and I, upon our death, to say, "Death, where is your sting?" How many times have we been to a funeral and been able to find hope? And the only hope we're able to find is, "Lord, you conquered death for us." And this is not the end of anything, but just barely the beginning. So we thank the Lord for life that is found in Jesus Christ. Now this morning, what we want to do is we want to come together and we want to focus on that which is important. And to do that, we want to kind of have some unity together. And so what we want to do to begin with is we kind of want to get on the same page. And so today I'm going to say, just so that we kind of get in sync, I want to say 1, 2, 3, go. And you guys are going to clap at the same time. Okay? The instructions clear? Okay. All right, so get your hands ready. All right, ready. 1, 2, 3, go. Now I want to read a verse. Our text verse is, now we're beginning a series today on Luke chapter number 24, based on Luke chapter number 24, verse number 4 and 5, and it came to pass that as they were much perplexed, this is Mary Magdalene and some of the ladies that went to the tomb early in the morning, and they found things in process, but once they got there, they were perplexed as they went into the tomb, and Jesus wasn't there, and they found the tomb empty. Behold, there were two men standing there in shining garment to their surprise, and they were perplexed, and they were afraid, and they bowed down their faces to the earth, and the men in shining garments said to them this, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" Basically what they had said was, you are missing the obvious. You are missing the obvious. You're probably familiar with Sherlock Holmes and Watson. There's a story told about Sherlock Holmes and his sidekick Watson. They went camping in the middle of the night. They woke up and Holmes says to Watson, "What do you see?" Watson says, "I see stars and stars and stars." And Holmes says, "What does that tell you?" And Watson says, "Well, astronomically, it tells me that there are billions of stars, millions of galaxies, and potentially millions of planets. Astrologically, it tells me that Saturn is in the constellation of Leo. Ortologically, it tells me that it's a 2:45 in the morning. Meteorologically, it tells me that tomorrow's probably going to be a beautiful day. Theologically, it tells me that God is sovereign and that we are just a small part of a great big whole. What does it tell you?" Holmes says, "Watson, you idiot, someone has stolen our tent. You missed the simple stuff trying to see the big stuff." And I told Brother Scott this week, I said, "You know what? There has to be a word. There has to be one word that means somebody has missed the big picture over the little picture. Somebody, you're missing the obvious. What is the word?" And I was trying to think of what is the word that means you missed the obvious. And we used a thesaurus and a dictionary, couldn't find it, trying to go to Scott, Googled it. You can Google it. Well, some cognitive scientists came up with a word. Actually, two words. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. You're going to learn some new words this morning. The word is this: inattentional blindness. Inattentional blindness means there's something there that was obvious,
You saw one thing, but you missed something else. Like Watson had missed over other things that somebody had stolen the tent. It kind of reminds you know what a naturist is versus a naturalist? A naturist is somebody who enjoys nature. They go camping. They enjoy camping. They enjoy nature. A naturalist is somebody who goes out and does stuff naked. You do not want to mix those terms, but a parent with a young child decided they wanted to carry their kid camping. They were naturists. They loved nature. So they found this place, and they let it skip their attention that it said naturalist. But they picked it up really quick as they saw a man and woman without clothing riding their bicycles toward them. And it dawned on them, this is not naturist, this is naturalist. So they were scared to death their young son was going to see these two people who were unclothed on their bicycles. So they whipped around real quick, just their son, as they were leaving, said, did you see them? They weren't wearing helmets. And we say all that because I want you to get a clear picture today of what it's like to miss the obvious. And they're like, whew. Thank Lord my child is not smart. My child missed the obvious. There are advantages, right? But what is it like for you and I as Christians, as believers, to miss the obvious? Because I believe what happens today on Easter Day so many times is that we do see certain things about the Christian life, things that are good, but we miss the stuff that's so important. We miss the stuff that can make a difference. We miss the things that are so meaningful. It's not that we don't see other things, but it's this inattentional blindness to that which is most significant in our lives. So what we do is we buy shirts that are like off color and light color so that we look like Easter eggs, but we miss the other stuff, and we even know the phrases. He is risen indeed. And that's true. But have you seen the obvious stuff of how it makes a real difference in your tomorrow? And in your life, and in your family, and your day-to-day life. If not, you are suffering from inattentional blindness. You'll remember the word when we're done today. Number one, what is it like? Here we have, again, get the picture. We have Mary Magdalene coming with her friends, these other ladies, very early in the morning. And they're coming, the Bible says, let's look at their expectation. Mary Magdalene, she gets up very early in the morning. The Bible says in verse number 1, now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the sepulcher. They came to the cemetery. They came to the graveyard. Now we all know what to expect at the graveyard, but here the Bible says they came to the sepulcher bringing spices which they had prepared. And she brought certain others with her. She brought some people to help. I used to do death calls for a funeral home for a co-op credit seminary, and I kept doing it for about 17 years. And when someone would pass, we would go and we would take them to the funeral home, and we would begin the preparation work for the funeral. And this time, in history, the preparation work was different. And because of the time that Jesus died, he died during Passover week. Brother Wes and I were talking about it, during the celebration time for the Jews. And because of the time that he died on Sabbath, there was a time where they could not prepare. So she was going to need Mary Magdalene, this person who Jesus had healed and blessed and had received so much from Jesus, went and had prepared spices, but she went to prepare the dead. That was the expectation. And so as you and I come to church, as you and I live a life that is revolved around Christ, we live in the Bible Belt, most of us have a Bible, most of us know religious stuff, we have certain expectations. Those expectations are divided between the natural and the supernatural. And I want you to understand that Mary Magdalene and her friends went purely on a naturalist level. We're going to prepare the body of Jesus Christ. We're going to prepare that body for that big sleep. This is the end. There's a stone that has to be rolled away. There's all these things that have to be done. There's some turning that's going to have to be done. There's some rewrapping that's going to have to be done. There's this stuff that's going to have to be done. This preparation that has to be done. There are certain expectations that have to happen. Just certain work that has to be done. And many people look at their Christian lives the exact same way. We just have certain expectations, certain things I need to do. There's just certain life that I need to live, and that's how it is. But if that's the only way you see your Christian life today, if that's the only way you see Resurrection Sunday today, then you are suffering from inattentional blindness. Number two, an examination. Now, this examination of the Christian faith only happens, and it happens in stages. As you get closer and closer to the Lord in relationship, you begin to see things differently. And I want you, if you would, to look at verse number 2 through verse number 5 at the stages of their examination. How that the closer that they get to where Jesus was, the more clearly they see what happened. How things begin to clear up for them. As they're far off, they notice, look at verse number 2. The Bible says in verse number 2, and they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. This they could have seen from far off. Now notice, when they see that, what were they thinking? They had to be thinking, hey man, something's going on here. Mary Magdalene had to be thinking, listen, I brought help to help me roll this stone away. Why is the stone rolled away? Something's going on. If you were to go to a funeral and you saw them cover the grave and you went the next day and it was uncovered, you would say to yourself, something's going on. You wouldn't say to yourself, something supernatural's going on. You would just say, something is going on. Somebody's got some splaining to do. Maybe good or bad, I don't know. It doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad thing. It's just something is going on. Maybe that's how you look at the Christian life. Maybe you're here today because you saw something in another person who said they were a believer, and their life looked like they had something that you didn't have, and you don't know that it's supernatural or not, but you said, hey, there's something going on. Or maybe you heard something about the group of believers at New Hope Baptist Church, and you're like, I don't know what it is, but there's something going on. Right? Because I tell you, I do the same thing. When I hear about a good restaurant, I don't mind going and trying it out. If I don't have a great experience, I'll try it out 2 times. I'm like, that really wasn't great. That didn't knock my socks off or blow my hat in the creek, but I'll go try it again. Because I like to eat. I'll give you another shot. Why? Because people tell me there's something going on right there. My wife and I tried a new place this last week on the way to get our taxes done. Wasn't super excited about getting our taxes done, but the restaurant was pretty cool. We enjoyed it. We might give it another shot. Something is going on. Natural, supernatural, I don't know. But they could see it a long way off. But look what happens in verse number 3. Now they get into the grave, there's a missing body. A, there's something going on. Now then the Bible says in verse number 3, and they entered in and found not the body of the Lord. Now this is not just something's going on, but something unusual is going on. I know this is where they put him, and I know this is where he belongs. This is unusual. This makes me think, right? So as I look at the Christian life, I know that there's some unusual stuff happening here. There's some unusual things. When I lived the life for self, and I looked at the Christian life, and I looked at people who seemed excited about the Christian life, I'm like, not just something just going on. There might be something unusual. This is something I didn't have before. It might be something that's a little different than what I have. There's something unusual going on. At one point in another chapter, the Bible says in another book, Mary sees Jesus and thought he was a gardener. It says, if you've taken him away, just tell me where he is and I'll go get him. If it's like a cleanup day, you need to move him and you're cleaning up and I need to go get him and bring him back, I can handle it. If there's something going on and it's unusual, this is not something I've ever heard of before, but if that's what's happening, then just tell me and I'll take care of it. And as you get closer to the Lord, as you get closer to the Lord in relationship, as you get closer to this Christian experience, what you're going to find is that there's not just something going on, there's something unusual going on. As you get closer to where God wants you to be and understanding the Christian paradigm and the Christian walk, you're going to kind of move away from this inattentional blindness. You're going to start seeing things for what they really are. From far off, everybody can see. Hey, listen, historically you can tell. Just from a clear, just a logical sense, you can know that Jesus was risen. You know one of the best apologetics for the idea that Jesus Christ was in fact risen from the dead? That his apostles and so many people were willing to die. Brother Joe was just telling Brother Joe, we're there in my chairs. I moved. Hey, I got my chair in the back. That's awesome. I moved around several different times, but my chairs were gone. But Brother Joe here was telling me he was just reading Fox's Book of Martyrs. I don't know if you've ever read Fox's Book of Martyrs. Kind of a long read, but it's full of people who were, especially in the first century, who had actually seen the resurrected Lord and were so convinced that they were willing to die. How many things in your life are you willing to die with? If you didn't believe that Jesus was really resurrected, fact of the matter is, who was the one who said, I will not believe unless I put my hand into his side and my fingers into his palms? Thomas. We just planted a church in Chennai, India. You know about the church? Just planted a sister church in Chennai, India. When I got to Chennai, India, we were traveling around. We were talking to some fellow believers. We were encouraging some churches. We were getting ready to plant this church. And Dr. P said, would you like to see the place where they martyred the Apostle Thomas? Like, let me think about it for you. Yes, I would. Where they martyred the Apostle, the same one who said, I will not believe it, that he is resurrected unless I see him with my own eyes. Then when he sees him, he's like, my Lord and my God. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. And Thomas was so convinced that he went to India. That's where he ended up. In Asia Minor, in India, to do what? To share the gospel with people. And he believed it so much he was willing to die. These people, listen, they see the Christian life as, listen, something's going on. The grave's open. Okay, people believe it. We'll dress up about it. But the body's missing. There's something unique going on. But it goes on. Notice then they see two angels in verse number 4. Verse number 4, the Bible says, and it came to pass that as they were much perplexed thereabout, they were like, where did the body go? What is going on? They're much perplexed thereabout. Behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Now they're like, wait a minute. Something's going on. Something unique's going on. Something supernatural is going on in this tomb. And I wonder if today, if you've taken time to notice that something in the Christian life, something supernatural is going on. We were talking about in the church membership class, briefly talking about why we do certain things that we do here at New Hope Baptist Church. Why? Because there are supernatural principles that tell the Christian to put yourself out, to go further than you have to go. Why? Because there are supernatural principles that define our life. And when you understand and you define your life by the supernatural, then all of a sudden you're willing to do weird things that you ordinarily weren't willing to do. The idea behind second mile Christianity, if a Roman compels you to go 1 mile, go within two. You imagine? Why would I do that?
Jew would say, I hate those Romans, they're mean.
He says, hey, if somebody asks for your coat, give them your cloak also, they take you to the law. He says, why? Why do that? Because there are supernatural principles that control your life, and you want to be a great Christian example to them. So as you're counting those steps off, count those steps off, and once you've got a mile, say, hey man, let's go another mile. He's like, what? Why would you do that? Well, while we're on the second mile, let me tell you about this guy. Let me tell you about Jesus who came. And he died for our sins, and they buried him, but he didn't stay buried. And Mary Magdalene and these women, they went, and they saw these two shining angels. And it was a supernatural. Jesus was a supernatural God. There was a supernatural event. Have you ever received the salvation of God in your life? I'm not asking if you know God. I'm asking you, have you ever had a supernatural event in your life? That's called salvation. Where you can say, one time I was dead, and now I am alive in Jesus Christ. The difference between being saved and lost. I'm not asking you if you're good. You're not. And that conversation is twice last week. Problem is, you thought you were good. Found out you wasn't. Can't believe I did that. Why not? I can't believe you can't believe. Right? Because you're not good. Have you ever had a supernatural experience in your life where God, through the blood of Jesus Christ and your yielded faith, turned you into something you weren't before? Or do you say, I'm just trying to do the best I can do? Really? Because that's not going to work. Some people have never gotten past the threshold of, yeah, the grave is empty. That's awesome. Jesus is awesome. His body's gone. He's risen from the dead. Awesome. But has that supernatural experience ever meant anything to you? Because the last thing that happens here in this examination that these ladies had in this tomb was this question. It was a personal question. It was a personal question about the obvious. And the question was what? Verse number 5. And as they were afraid, they bowed their faces to the earth. They said unto them, the two angels said to them, this question, the question that I would like to ask you today. Why are you seeking the living among the dead? Why are you seeking the living among the dead? Where were they? They were in the graveyard. Who were they looking for? Jesus. Why were they looking for Jesus? They thought he was still dead. Inattentional blindness. Say, Brother Tony, makes sense. They had killed him. They put him in the grave. Look, if you would, at Matthew chapter number 17 and verse number 22. Turn to Matthew chapter number 17 and verse number 22, unless you're on the YouVersion, and you're already there. The same Jesus that healed the sick, that raised the dead, that opened blind eyes, that fed 5,000, that confined the teachers, that told people their secret. The same Jesus that died on the cross told them this. And while they abode in Galilee, before they went to Jerusalem to die, said unto them, the Son of Man shall be betrayed in the hands of men. They shall kill him, and on the third day he shall rise again. And they were exceeding sorry. I'm going to be betrayed in the hands of men. They're going to kill me. And on 3 days, I'm going to rise again. Where's the sorry come in? The sorry comes in because inattentional blindness caused them to stop listening, and I'm going to be betrayed and killed. Because their life experience had never allowed them to see, or their over-spiritualized senses had not allowed them to see that Jesus meant, I'm rising again. I'm not staying in the graveyard except for 3 days. So after 3 days, they go to the graveyard. He's not there. They didn't see it. I don't understand. The angels asked him. I don't understand. I would ask you, why are you seeking life among a world that is full of death? And that is dead. Where are you trying to find life? Remember the t-shirts? Blank is life. Baseball is life. Golf is life. Life is life. I don't know if that shirt exists. Whatever is life. It used to be shirts. Everything is life. Whatever is life. I'm asking you what life is. Your life would be fulfilled if what? If what? I finally have life. I want it if what? Because you're not going to find it. If the answer is something secular and something worldly, you're seeking life among the dead. You're not going to find it in the cemetery of this world. The angel said, why are you seeking the living where the dead are? This is a cemetery. Jesus is not here. So they had this expectation. They had this examination, which things become clearer as you get closer to where you're supposed to be, closer to this supernatural experience. And then lastly, notice if you look at the explanation, I love this explanation. The angels tell them what they're trying to examine. The angel gives them this explanation. He kind of answers the question for them. It'll be an answered question for us today. Luke chapter 24, verse number 6. He is not here. That's what they saw. They can see that. He's not here. Yeah, I know. We know that first. We came here to find he's not here. That's what we see. That's what we know. That's, by the way, what we celebrate today. How many churches, how many of us, how often have I said, man, we're here to celebrate an empty tomb? I don't know if that's true. So much so as we're here to celebrate a risen Lord. Who spent, we're going to talk about during the series that we're starting today, Life After His Death, which talks about he spends 40 days after his resurrection telling his people, now this is what I have for you now. I died like I said I was going to die. I lived like I said I was going to live. I rose like I said I was going to rose. Here's what it means for you. Don't miss it. That's intentional blindness. Inattentional blindness. Notice what he says. He is not here. That's what they saw. He is risen. That's what they did not see. That was the inattentional blindness on their part. He is risen. Remember how he spake to you in Matthew chapter number 17, verse number 22 and 23? Remember how he spake to you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered in the hands of sinful men and crucified, the third day rise again? And they remembered his words. And returned from the sepulcher and told all these things to the 11 and to the rest. Because there were a bunch of followers who were confused about his death. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women that were with them, which told these things to the apostles. Listen to verse number 11. We're going to finish with this verse. And all their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed. Who are they talking to? Who are these ladies talking to? The disciples. So what do we have here? More intentional blindness. Like, hey, the angels told us that he's risen from the dead. And the disciples said, nope, that can't be it. The obvious can't be it. One, two, three. That cannot. Well, yeah, right. It can't be it. It can't, how many of you ever said that? It can't be that simple. Paul said it like this to the church which strayed away from Christ. He said, I'm amazed that you are so soon turned from the simplicity of the gospel. And Paul also writes, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. The simplicity of the idea that Jesus Christ came, he lived, he died, he rose again to change your world. That's what it's about. And if you miss the change your world part, then the Easter part is just your part of inattentional blindness. Man, this is awesome. Why is it awesome? Because Easter is just awesome. God is awesome. Only so awesome as it affects you. If my neighbor wins the lottery, I will not be excited for him. I don't know what to tell you, because I guarantee they're not fixing to share with me. What do I care? I don't know. Am I weird? Am I one? No, I ain't buying. You're not excited either. If I have a windfall in my life, you're going to be, man, Brother Tony, let's have a party. No. If you're not getting that, you'll be like, hey, well, where's mine? You're going to tell me, hey, if I kick over a bag of money, I'll bring you back. Why? Because it doesn't mean anything personal to me. And if the Christian life has not supernaturally changed you, you today and I today am suffering from inattentional blindness. We have missed the obvious. And person after person goes to church. Week after week. And they listen to things that have to do with open tombs and unique things and special things. But they miss the supernatural part of life that changes, that God has intended to change them and to change their family and to give them eternal life. It's available for you today. Don't miss the obvious this morning. Tonight at 6 we'll talk about, I've come that you might have life, that you might have it more abundantly. Did you miss the idea where God says, I intend for your life to be more than just natural? As the musicians come, more than just ordinary, but supernatural. Nicodemus comes to Jesus and says, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? And he says, you have to have a supernatural experience. You have to be born again. And Nicodemus was like, I don't understand. I know, because what I'm trying to tell you is something supernatural. It should be clear to you, but you missed it with inattentional blindness. He said, are you a leader of the Jews and you don't know this? How did you miss it? I just wonder how many of us have been to church and owned Bibles and have missed the supernatural power, the life-changing power, the family-changing power, the perspective-changing power of God in our life. Please don't miss it today. If you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, what a better spiritual birthday than Easter. Whatever the need is today, the altar's open. So we stand together. Whatever the need is, you come. Let's come and we'll sing.